So I'm going to kind of talk about how you can avoid the issues that Fred mentioned earlier with your images. So there are two pretty big journals, Embo Press and Rockefeller University Press, who publishes the JCB. And they have a pretty public publicized policy of routinely screening all of their accepted manuscripts for image issues. And even with this public policy, they've noticed that, sorry, I want to make sure I don't hit you guys in the head with the laser pointer. I'm really short, sorry. So 20 to 25% of them, oh, I didn't mean to get you guys to move. Just trying to like.
You're scary.
So about 20 to 25% of these manuscripts have, you know, some sort of issues with their images. And about 1% of these are serious enough to warrant revoking acceptance of those manuscripts. So a variety of questions, any questions that arise during the whole publication process from, you know, manuscript submission all the way until after publication, any sort of questions that that arise regarding the validity of these images, they can lead to anything from delays in review, publication, corrections, and, you know, the things that you guys don't want are withdrawals or retractions of your articles. I'm sure a few of you are probably aware of these two websites. One is Retraction Watch and the other one is PubPeer. So Retraction Watch is basically a blog website where they highlight any sort of recent retractions that are happening in the scientific literature. And PubPeer originally was started off as to start kind of like an online discussion or journal club about published articles. But now it's kind of turned into a repository where people comment where they think they found some inappropriate manipulation. And the way, you know, I detect these issues, and, you know, other people do as well, is that it's usually by visual inspection using Photoshop, as well as some tools that you can download from the Office of Research Integrity, or the ORI. So what can you guys do to make sure you're not featured on Retraction Watch or PubPeer? There's basically three steps. One is your data acquisition or your collection phase. Next is preparing your figures properly, and then of course you want to make sure you retain all of your data to make sure that, you know, you don't get an email from me asking for your original data. So the first thing I want to talk to you about are histograms, and if you're a photographer like Fred, you're probably used to seeing these in Photoshop or Lightroom, and basically It shows the tonal range of the image, how much is completely black and how much is completely white, and then all the gray values in between. So this is what an unmanipulated Western blot histogram would look like. See that none of these are completely black, none of the pixels are completely black, and then some are, none of these are completely white. When you have an underexposed image, you would see that this histogram here would be shifted over to the black edge. And then if you have an overexposed image, this histogram would again be shifted to the white. And what that happens is when you shift the histogram in either direction, you'll lose a lot of the subtle differences in your Western blot images. So you want to prevent that. So again, this is what a histogram looks like of this Western blot that has not been manipulated. You can see there's no pixels in the completely black range, and there's nothing completely in the white range. You have, you know, a lot of distribution in the gray area. And this is what it looks like when you drop the background. So you've adjusted it so there's hardly anything here in the white, or sorry, that you see mostly white background. And then if you look at the histogram, it's mostly white pixels that you see over here. If you compare, you know, this unmanipulated blot to the manipulated blot, you can see that you've lost like a lot of the subtle differences in your Western. So you want to prevent that. So how can you prevent it is, if a lot of you are still using flatbed scanners, this is kind of what you would see in your interface when you set your film down. First, you want to make sure you're scanning at 300 DPI, which is the standard resolution for publication. And then you have all these little boxes, and, you know, I'm not really sure what all of them mean, but basically they're just telling the scanner how you want the scanner to pick what are the completely white pixels and what are the completely black pixels. But you don't want the scanner to do that for you because it's not going to do it as well as you can. So make sure you click reset here and then uncheck any of these boxes. And that should make sure that you're, you know, getting the real capture of what's on that film that you have in front of you. A lot of you guys are also moving up to using the LiCor or other sort of imaging systems. And I believe when you scan using these systems, you'll get a histogram image at the very end. So you should make sure that when you're capturing it, you're not getting an image that looks like this. You're getting something that looks like this. Because when you have something that looks like this, the reviewer might look at it and it's like, I think these guys might be trying to hide something. You know, it doesn't look very transparent. Another thing is how you're saving your data. So you want to save your Western blot files or your any of your imaging files as TIFF files. It's a lossless compression. So these are two Western blots. They're both 300 dpi, but one was saved as a TIFF and this one is saved as a JPEG. I don't know if it's hard to see up on the screen, but there are some like little lines going through here as well as some pixelation. And any of these sort of artifacts that come up, you know, the reviewer may question, I think they may have done something here. It's a lot harder for us to be able to tell that you haven't manipulated the image in some way. And then figure preparation. As Roger mentioned, make sure you read the instructions to authors because that will give you a lot of good pointers on how you're preparing, making sure you're preparing your figures to the journal standards. And PowerPoint is really easy, but you should not prepare your figures in PowerPoint. They're really intended for making presentations at 72 dpi, which is the screen resolution, and actually resizing any of your Western blots or your microscopy images end up can cause some sort of compression. So you can lose some data when you're saving your figure files as PowerPoint. So instead, you should use programs that really were intended for doing high-resolution images, such as Photoshop or Illustrator. Finally, I think we've all been harping on this a lot, is data retention. So make sure, you know, you keep all of your original images that haven't been cropped or altered or manipulated anyway. And, you know, my PhD supervisor is always telling us to back up the backup and then back it up again. So make sure you have lots of copies of this because you really, if any questions arise during the review process or even post-publication, you want to be able to go back to them and say, look, here it is. There's nothing wrong with my image. There are some really good resources out there. The ORI, as I mentioned before, is the Office of Research Integrity. They have a really great online learning tool. It's kind of guidelines on how to prepare your images and what constitutes good image processing and what's bad image processing. And then this is kind of old now, but this is a JCB editorial on image manipulation. It's a really nice little editorial. And I believe that's it. Yep. If you have any questions, you know, you're always feel free to contact me. I'm at the ASBNB office.